Recorded Books and RB Digital present Wilmington's Lie, The Murderous Coup of 1898 and the Rise of White Supremacy by David Zucchino, narrated by Victor Bevine. Prologue. White Man's Country. Wilmington, North Carolina, November 10, 1898. The killers came by streetcar. Their boots struck the packed clay earth like muffled drumbeats as they bounded from the cars and began to patrol the wide dirt roads. The men scanned the sidewalks and alleyways for targets. They wore red calico shirts or short red jackets over white butterfly collars. They were working men, with calloused hands and sunburned faces beneath their wide-brimmed hats. Many of them had tucked their trousers into their boot tops and tied cartridge belts around their waists. A few wore neckties. Each one carried a gun. Throughout that summer and autumn, white men had been buying shotguns, six-shot pistols, and repeating rifles at hardware stores in the port city of Wilmington, North Carolina, set in the low Cape Fear country along the state's jagged coast. It was 1898, a tumultuous midterm election year. White planters and business leaders had vowed to remove the city's multiracial government and black public officials by the ballot or the bullet or both. Few white men intended to navigate election week that November without a firearm within easy reach. There was concern among whites in Wilmington, where they were outnumbered by blacks, that stores would run dry on guns and that suppliers in the rest of the state and in nearby South Carolina would be unable to meet the demand. Gun sales soared. J.W. Murchison, who operated a hardware store in downtown Wilmington, sold 125 rifles in October and early November alone. That was four or five times his normal sales. These were Colt and Winchester repeating rifles, capable of firing up to 16 rounds in rapid succession. Murchison also sold more than 200 pistols during that same period and nearly 50 shotguns. Owen F. Love, a smaller hardware dealer, sold 59 guns of all types during October and early November. Murchison and Love were proper white men, which meant they sold firearms only to other white men and primarily to those who were supporters of the white supremacist Democratic Party. They did not sell to blacks. When pressed on the subject later, Owen Love responded, "I had no objections to selling to any respectable man, white or colored, but I would refuse to sell cartridges, pistols, or guns to any disreputable Negro." Years later, one of the city's leading white supremacists wrote, "It is doubtful if there ever was a community in the United States that had as many lethal weapons per capita as in Wilmington at that time." This was only a slight exaggeration. Among the city's whites, there were almost as many guns as men, women, and children. Wilmington, with a population of 20,000, was the largest city in North Carolina, but the demand for weapons had exhausted the supplies of all the gun merchants in town. They telegraphed emergency orders to dealers in Richmond and Baltimore, who loaded guns and bullets onto railroad cars headed south. For months, whites had been railing against what they called Negro rule. Though black men held only a small fraction of elected and appointed positions in the city and the state, white politicians and newspapers warned that if blacks continued to vote and hold office, black men would feel empowered to seize white jobs, dominate the courts, and rape white women. "Nigger lawyers are sassing white men in courts. Nigger root doctors are crowding white physicians out of business," complained Colonel Alfred Moore Waddell, a former Confederate officer who led the white gunmen as they raced through the streets on the morning of November 10th. In 1898, a field representative for the American Baptist Publication Society called Wilmington the freest town for a Negro in the country. Three of the city's 10 aldermen were black, as were 10 of 26 city policemen. There were black health inspectors, a black superintendent of streets, and far too many, for white sensitivities, black postmasters and magistrates. White men could be arrested by black policemen and in some cases were even obliged to appear before a black magistrate in court. Black merchants sold goods from stalls at the city's public market, a rarity for a southern town at the time. Black men delivered mail to homes at times of day when white women were unattended. They sorted mail beside white female clerks. A black barber served as county coroner. The county jailer was black, and the fact that he carried keys to the lockup infuriated whites. The county treasurer was a black man who distributed pay to county employees, forcing whites to accept money from black hands. In 1891, President Benjamin Harrison had appointed a black man, John C. Dancy, as federal customs collector for the port of Wilmington. Dancy had replaced a white supremacist Democrat, and he drew an astonishing federal salary, $4,000 a year, or $1,000 more than the governor earned. A white newspaper editor ridiculed Dancy as Sambo of the Custom House. Black businessmen pooled their money to form two small banks that loaned cash to blacks starting small businesses. Several black professionals ran small law firms and doctor's offices, serving clients and patients of their own race. A black alderman from Raleigh, the capital, noted with some surprise that certain black men in Wilmington had built finely appointed homes with lace curtains, plush carpets, pianos, and even, he claimed, servants. The city's thriving population of black professionals contradicted the white portrayal of Wilmington's blacks as poor, ignorant, and illiterate. In fact, Wilmington's blacks had higher literacy rates than virtually any other blacks in North Carolina, a state in which nearly a quarter of whites were illiterate. For whites, this was an intolerable situation. The planters, lawyers, and merchants who had dominated Wilmington since its founding in 1739 had lost control of the city during the Civil War and Reconstruction. Through terror and intimidation by the night riders of the Ku Klux Klan, white supremacists had returned to power in the 1870s. They did not intend to surrender Wilmington again. The armed men emerging from streetcars on the mild, sunny morning of November 10, 1898, had heard rumors that black men, in response to white gunmen coursing through the streets, were massing at the corner of North 4th and Harnett Streets. The intersection lay at the heart of a predominantly black neighborhood known as Brooklyn. The white men were inflamed with excitement and eager to fire their weapons. Some had already shot rifles from a streetcar, sending rounds whistling past black homes and small businesses along nearby Castle Street. One of the men carried a .44 caliber U.S. Navy issue rifle, though he was not a member of the city's naval reserves. Others wielded army or police revolvers, belt revolvers, or small pocket revolvers. A few of the younger men still owned guns their fathers or uncles had fired during the Civil War. Some veterans called the weapons blueless guns because the dark blue finish had worn off to expose a dull gray color. The men moved in columns with their weapons raised in something approaching a military formation. They swept past clabbered houses and muddy yards in a mixed neighborhood of blacks and whites at the edge of Brooklyn. Wilmington was not yet a uniformly segregated city. In fact, some considered it the most integrated city in the South, with blacks and working-class whites living side by side in each of the city's five wards. But this was still the South. Some Wilmington neighborhoods were largely black, such as the First Ward and most of Brooklyn, or almost purely white, such as the tidy blocks of tree-lined streets near the Cape Fear River. Around 11 o'clock on November 10th, a group of whites from the mob arrived to find a crowd of black men gathered at North 4th and Harnett Streets, outside a popular drinking spot called Brungie's Saloon. Some of the men were known to whites as Sprunt Niggers. They worked as stevedores, laborers, and machine operators at the Sprunt Cotton Compress on the Cape Fear Riverfront. They loaded boulder-sized bales of cotton onto merchant ships bound for Europe. The Compress was the largest cotton export firm in the country, providing jobs to nearly 800 black men. Some of the Sprunt workers had abandoned their posts at the Compress after hearing rumors that a white mob was burning black homes in Brooklyn and plotting to butcher blacks at Sprunt's. No homes had been burned, and no one had been killed. But the Sprunt workers were convinced that their lives and the lives of their wives and children were at risk. they made their way to Brunji's saloon, where they could see packs of white gunmen descending on the clay streets of their neighborhood. The white men were cursing blacks. The black men bristled and cursed them back. The white men hollered for the blacks to disperse, which only offended and aroused them. A city newspaper reported that the black men were in a bad temper. They stood their ground, anxiously eyeing the growing cluster of armed white men on the opposite corner. As the two sides exchanged more curses and taunts, one of the white men shouted out the mob's purpose. They were going gunning for niggers, he said. The rising tensions pierced the tranquility of a pleasant fall day, bright and cool, with a gentle river breeze. A black man named Norman Lindsay tried to calm his neighbors. He told them that their families were in danger of being burned out and shot dead if they continued to antagonize the white men. For the sake of your lives, your families, your children, and your country, go home and stay there. I'm as brave as any of you, but we are powerless, Lindsay told them in a defeated tone. The black men argued with him. They insisted that they had every right, as citizens and residents of their neighborhood, to gather where they pleased, particularly with their families under threat from a mob seemingly bent on murder. Aaron Lockamy, a white police officer, decided to offer his services as a mediator. Lockamy did not look or act like a police officer. He was a middle-aged man, deliberative and tentative. Even at 58, he was not an experienced cop. He had served only on occasional part-time duty before he was deputized earlier that month as a full-time officer in anticipation of trouble during the week of the election. Lockamy wore his police badge prominently on his chest that morning. He had been stationed in Brooklyn to monitor the opening at 8 o'clock of two saloons elsewhere on North 4th Street. He had been instructed by the city's white police chief not to arrest anyone, black or white. He was simply to keep an eye on the saloons. Negotiation was not part of his job, but Lockamy believed he could appeal to the more reasonable men among the two camps in the showdown near the saloon. When Lockamy appeared at the corner of Harnett and North 4th Streets, looking hesitant, he was summoned by several white men gathered there. They asked him, not very politely considering that he was a fellow white man, to move the black man off the corner. Lockamy sighed. He walked over to the men. They seemed wary and defensive. They did not appear to be carrying weapons, at least not overtly. Lockamy persuaded the black men to move a short distance to the opposite corner, by W.A. Walker's grocery store, a frame structure with a low, tilted roof that shaded a wooden slat walkway. This provided a slightly better opportunity for them to gauge the intentions of the white mob. The whites responded by moving to a more protected position just down the street from Brunji's saloon, near the white steeple of St. Matthew's Evangelical Lutheran Church. The black men's new position did not satisfy all the white men. Several of them summoned Officer Lockamy again. They dispatched him once more to try to move the black men. Again, the blacks rebuffed him and continued to hold their ground. Lockamy trudged back to the white men. They demanded to know what the blacks had told him. They told me that I might go to hell or where I pleased, Lockamy said evenly. They were not going anywhere. They did not need me over there, no how. The white men were through with Lockamy. They told him they would move those Negroes themselves. Lockamy gave up trying to negotiate. He decided to return to his original mission of monitoring the two saloons farther south on North 4th Street. He had walked about a block from the crowded corner when he heard a sharp volley of gunfire. 10 blocks away stood the Wilmington Light Infantry Armory, a two-story Greek Revival building of pale white marble and pressed brick that towered over Market Street. Billeted inside were more than 100 well-drilled soldiers who had recently returned from federal duty in the Spanish-American War. The Light Infantry was part of the state's militia system. It ostensibly reported to the state adjutant general and thus ultimately to North Carolina's governor in Raleigh. But the infantry effectively served as the private militia of Wilmington's white supremacists, many of them related by blood or marriage. An appointment to the light infantry was a symbol of achievement and social standing. Prospective members had to be approved by current members, ensuring that the light infantry remained a closed club for upper-class and middle-class whites wedded to white supremacy. Earlier that summer, the city's white merchants worried that the light infantry lacked the firepower to properly intimidate and control Wilmington's black majority. They raised $1,200 to purchase a Colt rapid-fire gun for the unit. It was a relatively new weapon, developed just 9 years earlier. Under optimum conditions, the air-cooled gun could fire up to 420 rounds in extended bursts without overheating the barrel. A few blocks away, another militia, the Naval Reserves, was also ready and waiting on the morning of November 10th. The Reserves, formerly known as the North Carolina Naval Militia, was a more egalitarian unit than the Wilmington Light Infantry. While men from the gentry dominated the Naval Reserve's upper ranks, middle-class and working-class men were permitted to join. Most were from families active in the white supremacy campaign. Like the men of the Light Infantry, members of the Naval Reserves had served on federal duty during the Spanish-American War, aboard the USS Nantucket off South Carolina. They too returned to Wilmington late that summer. And they too were supposed to report to the governor, but served instead as a local white supremacist militia. The Naval Reserves had been supplied with its own rapid-fire gun, a Hotchkiss gun that could fire 80 to 100 rounds a minute. The gun's bore was 3/4 of an inch. Its effective range was 5 miles. At 3 miles, the steel rounds were said to be able to penetrate a thick steel plate. One of Wilmington's white newspapers called it a very destructive piece of ordnance. Just before midday on November 10th, reports of gunshots at North 4th and Harnett Streets reached the militiamen of the Light Infantry and the Naval Reserves. The men began to muster. They readied their weapons. Their new rapid-fire guns had been mounted on horse-drawn wagons. The orders came to move out. The soldiers and sailors rushed to Brooklyn, the wagon wheels churning, the men holding onto their hats and clutching their rifles, the animals snorting and panting, the two big guns cocked and ready to fire. Book 1. Days of Hope. Chapter 1. Cake and Wine. Wilmington, North Carolina, winter 1865. The closing weeks of the Civil War brought chaos and upheaval to Wilmington. In late February 1865, great fires rose up, belching oily black smoke across the city. Supplies of rosin, turpentine, and cotton bales were set alight, not by invading Union troops, but by fleeing Confederates. General Braxton Bragg and his army had managed to move most of their materiel out of Wilmington to use during their retreat, but Bragg ordered the remaining supplies put to the torch to keep them from the enemy. Union troops were bearing down on the city a month after their capture of Fort Fisher, a Confederate fortress of earth and sand battlements 20 miles south of Wilmington, where the Cape Fear River flowed into the Atlantic. The U.S. Navy had unleashed upon Fort Fisher the heaviest naval bombardment in history at the time. The fall of the fort in January 1865 had closed all access to the port of Wilmington, the Confederacy's last functioning seaport. For much of the war, Wilmington's sleek blockade runners had skirted an armada of Union warships strung like beads off the Atlantic coast. After New Orleans and Norfolk were captured by Union forces in the spring of 1862, and Vicksburg fell in July 1863, and with Charleston under Union siege for much of the war, Wilmington had become the main source of weapons, clothing, food, and supplies for the Confederacy. Among the Union units that overran Fort Fisher in January 1865 were colored brigades that included black soldiers from Wilmington. As Union forces approached Wilmington that February, General Bragg destroyed several railroad lines leading out of the city and set fire to bridges, wharves, and shipyards. Portions of the main rail line, the Wilmington, Charlotte, and Rutherford Railroad, remained intact, though some of the rails on the line would later be ripped up for use as scrap iron by Union troops. Before the Confederate soldiers retreated, some looted shops. When Union soldiers arrived, they looted too. Food shortages broke out. Whole hams were briefly offered for sale at the preposterous price of $525, corn sold for $40 a bushel, and salt pork for $6 a pound. People begged for food on the streets. By the time General Alfred Howe Terry led a column of Union soldiers on bay chargers to City Hall to take command of Wilmington on February 22nd, the city had become a vast refugee camp. Many Union soldiers released from Confederate prisoner of war camps were afflicted with jail fever, typhus, a contagion characterized by rash, chills, and fever that killed two doctors who treated them. Carpenters struggled to build enough caskets for the estimated 40 to 50 people who died daily, from jail fever, but also battle wounds, sepsis, or other maladies. Every available house or outbuilding was crammed with people seeking shelter. One visitor claimed that rents in Wilmington were higher than in New York City. Thousands of people lived in camps, tents, or shanties, watched over warily by an occupying force of nearly 15,000 Union soldiers, among them blue-suited colored troops. The Wilmington Herald reported that despite a large force of darkies cleaning the streets, the city was an open sewer. There is not a private residence, a kitchen, a business house of any kind, but has now filth enough about and around its doors to make every person in the city sick. No person can pass without holding their breaths. Cows, pigs, cats, dogs, and low Negroes are together in this pen. For blacks in Wilmington, the end of the war left their lives only slightly less constrained and miserable than before. Any civil liberties envisioned by the Emancipation Proclamation had not materialized by the summer and fall of 1865. The full remedies of Reconstruction had not yet taken hold in the city so soon after the end of the war. Just a few months earlier, a black woman, three black children aged 1, 5, and 7, a black girl, and 4 mules had been offered for sale in town. The same day, a railroad company offered a $50 reward for the return of a slave named Dick, who had escaped from his owner, the railroad superintendent. Dick was considered guilty of insolence as well as escape. His master noted that the missing slave carries himself with his shoulders considerably thrown back. Even with Wilmington under federal military control, freedmen could expect no special protection. Union troops were spread thin, making it difficult to restore law and order in the face of Southern defiance. Barely 6,000 federal troops were still stationed in North Carolina by late 1865, the smallest Union force in any Southern state. And by the fall of 1865, 3/4 of Union troops who had fought in the war had been mustered out nationwide. Union commanders, seeking the most efficient ways to get local government functioning again, turned to the men who knew how to run local affairs. Wilmington's former mayor, an ardent white supremacist, was restored to his post by the local Union command. The mayor quickly installed a former Confederate general as his chief of police, presiding over a new force composed mainly of former Confederate soldiers. Just after the war ended, President Andrew Johnson sent Carl Schurz, a German immigrant, to tour North Carolina and report on conditions there. Schurz later told the president that whites resisted any attempt to grant equal rights to their former slaves. "Wherever I go, the street, the shop, the house, the hotel, or the steamboat, I hear the people talk in such a way as to indicate that they are yet unable to conceive of the Negro as possessing any rights at all," Schurz wrote. "The people boast that when they get freedmen's affairs in their own hands, to use their own expression, the niggers will catch hell." Cape Fear rice and cotton plantation owners, though under Union occupation and stripped of their slaves, still wielded considerable influence. Some plantations had been seized by the Federal Military District of Wilmington and settled with freed slaves in April 1865. But General Joseph Hawley, a dedicated abolitionist who had settled slaves on the plantations, was replaced in June 1865 by General John Worthington Ames, an ardent conservative. In September, Ames evicted the former slaves and returned plantations to their white owners under a national policy instituted by President Johnson. Freedmen who worked on Cape Fear plantations were supposed to be paid for their labor, but the Freedmen's Bureau in Wilmington was inundated with complaints from black workers that white plantation owners had reneged on promises to pay them to bring in the harvests in the summer and fall of 1865. General Ames made a show of imposing Union authority. A general order issued on July 10, 1865, for instance, prohibited former Confederates from wearing Confederate rank as required by good taste and a respect for the government of their country. But Ames was willing to be courted by the white supremacists who seethed under his command. One leading black man in the city attributed the tendency of Union officers to accommodate their former enemies to the cake and wine influence, the extravagant Cape Fear hospitality resurrected from antebellum society. The white men accustomed to running Wilmington were bitter and resentful after the war. Under General Ames, Northern troops afforded white police officers wide latitude to violently counter any attempts by blacks to assert their limited rights. Most of the new police officers did not wear uniforms. They wore only a small yellow star that served as a police badge. They received no training as policemen, but they brought to the job their military skills and their contempt for blacks. They preyed on freed slaves, whipping the men in public and beating the women with boards. In the countryside, former Confederate soldiers banded with white residents to form county militia companies that rampaged through the area, terrorizing black families in their homes. W.H.H. Beadle, a Union lieutenant colonel stationed in Wilmington, was appalled by the attacks. Colonel Beadle had been installed as a local officer of the Freedmen's Bureau, established by Congress in March 1865 to advance the rights and living conditions of freed slaves. Although nearly 40% of food rations distributed by the Bureau in the summer of 1865 went to white families. It was a thankless task, and it frustrated Beadle. He realized that the whites of Wilmington had not truly been defeated. He watched them return from the war unbowed, full of rage, and more committed than ever to white supremacy. He was convinced that whites would have reclaimed blacks as slaves if not for the Freedmen's Bureau. They would endeavor to return them to a system of peonage immediately, Colonel Beadle reported. Colonel Beadle once saw a frail black woman clubbed unconscious by a white officer because she had been drinking in public. In another incident, Beadle watched a dog bite a white policeman as the officer was beating a black boy on the street. The boy's entire family, which owned the dog, was thrown into jail. The policemen are the hardest and most brutal-looking and acting set of civil or municipal officers I ever saw. All look bad and vicious, Beadle reported. The police whippings inspired other white men in the city, and physical abuse of blacks was perhaps more rampant than ever. White civilians often flogged blacks in public, typically unimpeded by police or on many occasions by Union soldiers. A colored man sometimes does not know who attacks him or why, Colonel Beadle reported. One day, he recalled, a white man pointed a revolver at a young black man, then choked him, whipped him with a club, tied his hands, whipped him with half a hoop, kept him tied 6 or 7 hours, whipping him every few minutes with a doubled leather strap, hurting him so bad as to disable him for 2 days. Police arrested blacks on trumped-up charges such as vagrancy or trespassing, then forced them, in some cases, to work without pay. During a visit to Wilmington in the summer of 1865, a reporter for the Philadelphia Inquirer took note of tense race relations in a city where blacks were nominally free, and where whites had been defeated and occupied by their northern enemy. The reporter wrote of whites, "They perceive insolence in a tone, a glance, a gesture, or failure to yield enough by 2 or 3 inches in meeting on the sidewalk." Physical abuse of freed blacks by white police officers and citizens was rampant on and off the plantations. Plantation squatters were evicted by force. Police seized guns owned by black men. They searched their homes and seized their belongings. In the summer of 1865, an officer in a Freedmen's Bureau office in Wilmington maintained a ledger of complaints of whippings and beatings filed by former slaves. By colored man Dick, the J.W. whipped him severely, striking him 72 blows. By colored woman Martha, the J.F. Parker overtook her while on her way to the office of the superintendent of freedmen, put one end of rope around her neck, tied the other round the neck of his mule, and so dragged her more than 2 miles. By colored woman Louisa, the J.T. is whipping her children continually, and when she asked him not to do it, ordered her off his place and told her not to come back. By colored man Elias, that some citizens took his gun away from him and told him no nigger had the right to carry a gun. By colored man Levi, that WFL has whipped him severely with a buggy trace, shows his back all raw. Wilmington's new police officers were not the only white men given free rein by some Union troops. County militias, formed to protect white interests, roamed the Cape Fear countryside. The militias were an outgrowth of the Confederate Home Guard, formed during the war to track down and punish Confederate deserters, among other duties. After the war, many Home Guards joined county militias, which raided black homes on the pretexts first of confiscating illegal firearms and later of recovering stolen property. Militiamen descended on black dwellings, confiscating cash, personal items, and farm equipment. The militias were especially proficient at appropriating horses and mules, many of them awarded to former slaves by the Union Army. Sometimes the militiamen brought their friends along on raids of black homes so that they might share in the spoils. A tour of pretended duty is then turned into a spree. Houses of colored men have been broken open, beds torn apart and thrown about the floor, and even trunks opened and money taken, Colonel Beadle, the Union officer, reported. Some Union soldiers shared white Southerners' contempt for blacks. Among them were soldiers from border states or former Confederate states, including men who had once owned slaves. In Charleston in July 1865, a squad of Union soldiers attacked blacks and destroyed their stalls at a city market, then bayoneted to death a black man who protested. In Mississippi that same year, federal soldiers who had received a complaint from a plantation owner about his troublesome former slaves responded by flogging the black men. Across the South, Union commanders complained about the casual use of the slur "nigger" by their troops. And the discrimination extended to black soldiers' pay, which was supposed to be the same as for whites, $13 a month. But blacks were paid $10 a month, with $3 deducted for clothing. In Wilmington, blacks seethed over abuse of freedmen by local whites under the noses of Union soldiers. The city's white authorities complained in a letter to the provisional governor that colored soldiers, motivated by smothered revenge, were inciting local blacks to mount an insurrection against white authority. In February 1866, black soldiers marched to Wilmington City Jail to protest the whipping of black prisoners by white jailers. They stormed the lockup and freed the captives. Such incidents unnerved both local whites and white Union occupiers. Ultimately, federal military commanders replaced black troops with white soldiers along the lower Cape Fear. The Wilmington Journal, edited by William L. Saunders, the state's Ku Klux Klan leader, noted an emerging alliance of whites, northern and southern. The true soldiers, whether they wore the gray or the blue, are now united in their opposition, called a conspiracy and resistance, if you will, to Negro government and Negro equality. Blood is thicker than water. Chapter 2. Goodwill of the White People. Everyone called him Colonel, even his wife, though Alfred Moore Waddell had never quite earned the rank. He had served as a Confederate lieutenant colonel for less than a year during the Civil War, and his brief command of North Carolina's 3rd Cavalry ended in shame. After serving without any record worth mentioning, Waddell wrote years later, he abruptly resigned his command at the pinnacle of the war in August 1864. My health was completely wrecked, he wrote. He was, he confessed, an invalid. He was 29 years old. He went home to Wilmington a broken man. Just a few months later, in the spring of 1865, Waddell had recovered his health and his reputation. With Wilmington's white leadership in disarray under Union occupation, he filled a political vacuum by positioning himself as the city's leading voice of enduring white supremacy. His mediocre performance as a Confederate officer did not impede his political rise. Waddell took charge of white resistance to the rising tide of freedmen flowing into Wilmington. Even with blacks evicted from plantations and harassed daily by white police officers, Waddell helped lead a campaign to crush any attempts by blacks in the Cape Fear country to assert their newly won rights. He was a natural choice, given his upbringing and pedigree. Waddell was born into North Carolina's white planter aristocracy in 1834 in Hillsborough, a town in the rolling Piedmont landscape of central North Carolina. He was raised on a plantation built by his great-grandfather, Alfred Moore, a U.S. Supreme Court justice. Two other great-grandfathers, General Hugh Waddell and General Francis Nash, had been Revolutionary War officers. Waddell studied law at the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill, graduating in 1853. 5 years later, his family's political connections helped earn him an appointment as a clerk of court in New Hanover County. He moved to Wilmington, the county seat, and began a long career as a lawyer, essayist, historian, and public speaker. Even as a young man freshly admitted to the state bar, Waddell exhibited sharply calibrated political instincts. He sensed the prevailing winds and bent accordingly. In the late 1850s, when Unionist sentiment was strong in Wilmington, Waddell had aligned himself with Unionists opposed to secession. He bought the Wilmington Herald newspaper to promote his Unionist views. In January 1861, just before the outbreak of the Civil War, North Carolina secessionists seized two small military forts, Fort Johnston and Fort Caswell, which guarded access to Wilmington at the mouth of the Cape Fear south of the city. In an editorial in the Herald, Waddell objected to the takeovers. He pointed out that North Carolina was still a loyal member of the Union and bound by United States law. But the bold attacks on the forts inflamed secessionist sentiment in Wilmington, and soon Unionists were in retreat. Waddell adjusted accordingly. Just 18 days after writing the editorial, he attended a secessionist rally in Wilmington, where he performed an abrupt about-face. He told the meeting that there was no longer any hope of North Carolina's remaining in the Union. He was now fully in favor of secession. He declared himself a loyal Confederate. By June 1865, Waddell's days as a Unionist seemed forgotten, and he emerged as an unofficial spokesman for Wilmington's aggrieved white ruling class after the war. That month, he wrote an anguished letter to North Carolina's provisional post-war governor, William Woods Holden. He told the governor that black soldiers posted in Wilmington posed a mortal threat to the white population. He referred to daily outrages by colored troops. They insult and curse the most respectable ladies in Wilmington, Waddell wrote. Other whites complained in letters to the governor that the city's black residents still insist that they are entitled to all the social and political rights of white citizens. Though Governor Holden was a Republican who would later instigate a war against the Ku Klux Klan, he had issued a proclamation in June 1865 advising blacks not to expect to be granted suffrage or other civil rights immediately. Those sentiments were consistent with presidential Reconstruction, then in effect under President Johnson, a white supremacist Southerner born in Raleigh and raised in Tennessee. Johnson sought to bring the Southern states back into the Union, with slavery technically outlawed, but with white supremacy largely unchallenged and blacks granted limited rights, which did not necessarily include the right to vote. In July 1865, a group of freedmen invited Waddell to speak at the Wilmington Theater. They acknowledged the colonel as the public face of white supremacy in the city. Through Waddell, they sought to gauge the depth of hostility toward freed slaves and their new place in the post-war era. Both blacks and whites were struggling to define just what it meant to be a freedman at a time when nearly 4 million former slaves were now liberated, among them 360,000 in North Carolina. For whites in Wilmington, blacks had ceased to be slaves, but they had not ceased to be black. They were still considered unworthy, unequal, and inferior, still subservient to whites by any measure, social, political, or economic. For freed slaves, the defeat of the Confederacy and the end of slavery promised not just citizenship and the right of black men to vote, but also the right to work for fair pay and to live on something approaching an equal, if separate, status with the whites who had so recently enslaved them. They sought to be free citizens, not just free Negroes. And now they wanted to measure the gap between their vision and Colonel Waddell's. Waddell accepted the speaking invitation. He was eager to publicly dictate the terms of post-war race relations in Wilmington. And for him, and the white aristocracy he represented, those terms were the same terms that had always circumscribed the daily lives of blacks under white domination. Whites would continue to rule, blacks would continue to obey. Waddell announced that he intended to speak upon the proper condition of the freedmen under the present state of affairs. Though he had limited formal training, Waddell considered himself a learned historian. He had convinced himself that no other white man in Wilmington possessed his ability to draw lessons from the past and prescribe the future. one of Wilmington's white-owned newspapers, called Waddell a ripe scholar and a gentleman of culture and scholarly achievements. Waddell titled his speech, "An Address Delivered to the Colored People by Their Request." On a still July night, when the Cape Fear oozed humidity, the seats of the Wilmington Theater were filled by the city's leading black men, fanning themselves in the oppressive heat. Some wore dark suits with high white collars, as proper in appearance as any white man. Others wore workmen's clothes. Seated on the stage behind Waddell was the city's white mayor, flanked by several white dignitaries. Waddell strode across the stage like a military officer. The colonel was not a big man, but he carried himself in a way that suggested command and authority. He stood 5'9", with a large head, shaggy eyebrows, a long patrician nose, and calm gray eyes. On this evening, he was dressed in his customary dark wool suit, his wavy hair brushed back and his well-groomed beard forming a broad V at his chest. As Waddell addressed the black men, he was characteristically condescending. He began with a bold lie, which his audience received in silence. He assured them that whites meant blacks no harm. His vision was of two races, one superior, one servile, but the two sides living in harmony. It would be a mistake, he said, to suppose that the white people among you who were born and raised, with whom you played when you were children and served as you grew up, have all at once turned to be your enemies. He was interrupted by a round of polite applause, for even the black men recognized the thin thread of humanity that had linked children of both races since slavery. Waddell mentioned that some ignorant and misguided colored people are under the impression that they are not only free, but that the property of their former owners will be taken and given to them. Of course, this is a cruel mistake. Then Waddell laid down the law as he saw it. He told the black men they were not likely to be granted the vote any time soon. Perhaps some of them might vote someday with certain provisions, he said. Personally, Waddell said, he favored a test of intelligence or property or both for prospective voters of any race. I believe that there are some colored men in this hall who could vote now with quite as intelligent a conception of what they were doing as many white men. But I believe also that a large percentage of the colored people are not yet qualified to exercise this privilege. They would be mere tools in the hands of demagogues. No one in the audience objected, at least not publicly. The black men seemed to obey the Southern rules of civility that obliged both races to extend simple courtesies under certain social conditions. According to a white reporter for the Wilmington Herald, the most perfect order was maintained by everyone. Nor was there more than a slight stir in the audience when Waddell instructed freedmen to establish their own segregated schools as a way to do all you can to show the world that you deserve and can maintain the freedom and the privileges which have been bestowed upon you. Waddell reminded the former slaves that they were indeed fortunate to share a city as fine as Wilmington with white men. The great advantage which your race enjoys here is contact and daily association with the white race. Their influence upon you, as far as civilization is concerned, must be beneficial, and therefore you ought to cultivate the friendship and goodwill of the white people. Waddell also advised blacks to stop moving to Wilmington in search of work. He and other whites feared they would soon be outnumbered by freed slaves and their families, who sought shelter and work in the state's largest city, with its busy port, its rice and cotton exports, and its artisan trades. Waddell instructed itinerant blacks to find work on farms, in timber swamps, in the tar and turpentine trade among the towering longleaf pine forests, or along the railroad lines outside town, and to leave Wilmington for the whites who owned it. There was polite applause. The speech ended, and the white man and his black audience made their separate ways out of the theater and into the hot night. A few hours later, the body of a soldier from the United States colored troops was found floating in the Cape Fear River, his face flayed by buckshot. Chapter 3. Lying Out. It was often permissible for a white man in Wilmington to side with Union soldiers against blacks, but it was unforgivable for him to join with Northerners in attacks on other Southern white men. Even as the Civil War drew to a close, Confederate Home Guards continued to roam the Cape Fear countryside much as they did during the war, enforcing a brutal form of righteous justice. Home Guard patrols made it their business not only to terrorize blacks, but also to hunt down and punish white Southerners who had betrayed the Confederacy by secretly conspiring with invading Union troops. And should the Home Guards be arrested by Union soldiers, Wilmington's leading lawyer, Colonel Waddell, stood ready to defend them. In the spring of 1865, Matthew Sykes, a notorious Yankee sympathizer, lived in the flat, humid, piney woods along the Cape Fear River, about 40 miles northwest of Wilmington. Sykes and his family had been Unionists before the war, but he was pressured to join the Confederate Army after hostilities began. To avoid a long conscription, Sykes reluctantly enlisted for a limited tour of duty. He completed his service in June 1864. Several months later, he began secretly serving the invading Union Army as a spy and guide. He participated in the rapid advance of Union troops from Fort Fisher through Wilmington and into the Piney Woods in early 1865. Worried about the safety of his wife, Catherine, Sykes requested a week's leave to return home in the spring of 1865. But by the end of his leave, Union forces had already swept past his home region in the Piney Woods, clearing the way for surviving Home Guard squads to operate freely. The leader of the local Home Guard was Neil McGill, a Confederate officer whose family homestead was among the properties looted by Union troops in the nearby farming village of Elizabethtown, about 50 miles upriver from Wilmington. A fellow Confederate had told McGill that the damn son of a bitch, Matt Sykes, was a secret scout with the Yankee marauders. McGill vowed to hunt down and punish the white traitor. There was a tactic among Unionists in North Carolina known as lying out, sleeping in the forest to avoid being attacked at home late at night by home guards and county militias. Matt and Catherine Sykes had been lying out for most of the week. But on April 10, 1865, Palm Sunday, a cool rainy day, they decided to spend the night at the double-frame house of Catherine's father, Elias Edwards. Matt went to sleep, but Catherine stayed up late, sitting by the fire. 2 hours before dawn, she heard noises outside. She looked out and saw that Neil McGill and two Home Guard companions had crept up to the house. Catherine ran to wake her husband. She hid Matt, still in his nightclothes, beneath a dense pile of raw cotton inside a storeroom. McGill and his men, armed with pistols, knocked at the front door. Elias Edwards answered, and the men announced that they had come for Sykes. Edwards tried to stall them. He asked, "Which Sykes?" But McGill and the others pushed roughly past Edwards and searched the house by torchlight. One of the men kicked at the cotton pile and discovered Sykes. "Don't kill him," Catherine shouted. McGill bound Sykes's hands with a strand of rope. The home guards began to haul Sykes toward the door and into the damp night in his nightgown. Catherine begged them to let her fetch her husband's clothes. As the men waited, they accused Sykes of having piloted Yankees, leading Union soldiers to their homes. One of the home guards, John McMillan, said he wanted to kill Sykes as badly as he wanted to kill any goddamn Negro. He told Sykes he intended to hang him without judge or jury. Sykes, now fully dressed and with his hands still bound, was ordered to sit between McMillan and Elias Edwards. Edwards asked McMillan what they intended to do with his son-in-law. They would certainly do something with him, McMillan replied, but they would not need a jail. McGill gestured toward Sykes and said, "He lives between two fires, the North, or the Yankees ought to kill him for deserting their army, and the South will kill him." Then the men led Sykes away. McMillan told him to say goodbye to his family because he would never see them again. McGill and his men, hauling their captive, made their way from the Edwards home to a spot known as the 8 Mile Post. They paused there to drink whiskey. The three home guards were on foot. Sykes, his hands bound, sat astride the men's horses. They offered him a drink. Sykes did not respond. His face was buried in his hands, and he was weeping. McMillan eyed Sykes and felt a stab of pity. He told the others, "Boys, he has not done enough to us. Don't let us kill him." McGill was unmoved. Suddenly, he yanked Sykes from the horse and threw him to the ground. McGill and the others stomped, kicked, and beat Sykes until they thought he was dead. They then stabbed him in the ribs and hanged his body from a sapling. It did not take the Edwards and Sykes clans long to mount a search party. Nearly 36 relatives and neighbors assembled on horseback at Edwards' home after first light to begin the search for Matt. Catherine Sykes and Unity Sykes, Matt's mother, were among them. Progress was slow. The woods and fields were thick with wire grass and longleaf pines and scrub oaks. The ground was carpeted with damp pine needles. Rain had washed out some tracks. But soon the search party came across faint tracks of man and a horse. The depressions in the soft soil led down past the 8-mile post to Shady Grove, a corduroy track made of sand-covered logs. The group followed the track through a swampy bog known as Juniper Bay and onto a spot called Piney Island. They crossed a field and came upon a sapling with a rope attached. At the end of the rope hung the body of Matt Sykes. Matt's mother went over to him. She saw that her son's legs were splayed and did not touch the ground. There was enough space for Unity to place her foot between her son's foot and the damp soil. Someone cut Matt down. His chest and stomach bore wounds, and there were deep cuts on his chin, neck, and torso. One side of his face looked as though it had been skinned. Not long afterward, McGill and McMillan were captured by Union military authorities and taken before a court-martial in Wilmington in October 1865. The Home Guard supporters hired one of the best-known lawyers in the Cape Fear country and the only attorney in Wilmington at the time, the former Confederate officer, Alfred Moore Waddell. The colonel called his clients highly respectable men and their military trial an absurdity. Waddell built his defense on denigrating the character of Matt Sykes and his family and, by extension, the reputation of all residents of the Piney Woods. Outsiders were sometimes taken aback by the rough ways of the Piney Woods people, and Waddell used this prejudice to his advantage. He persuaded one defense witness to say of a Piney Woods woman who had testified on behalf of the Sykes family, "She is a woman of loose virtue, very low." In his summary to the court, Waddell administered what he considered the coup de grace. Unity Sykes, he announced, was the mother of a colored child. He offered no evidence, but he went on to claim that the entire Sykes clan and their neighbors in the Piney Woods lived together in one foul nest of vice and infamy. Waddell described the defendants, on the other hand, as upstanding citizens and stout defenders of the South. He argued passionately for acquittal. Sykes was arrested by McGill and McMillan in the discharge of their duties as members of the Home Guard, Waddell told the court. He was delivered by them to the cavalry and was executed by the cavalry. The military panel was not swayed. It pronounced the two Home Guards guilty of murder. They were sentenced to die. McGill and McMillan were held in Wilmington's brick jail, guarded by a single Union sentry. One day, the sentry was approached by a distinguished-looking white man who described himself as a supporter of the two condemned men. He offered a bribe. The sentry agreed in return for a cash payment to smuggle in a jackknife that would let McGill and McMillan carve a small escape hole and then to stand aside as they fled. In the end, the Union sentry delivered more than he had promised. He used his military bayonet to carve a hole in a back wall near the prison fireplace where the bricks were only a foot thick. From inside the jail, McGill and McMillan chipped away with the smuggled jackknife. Just after 3 a.m. on February 23, 1866, the efforts of the three men hacked out an opening measuring 16 by 19 inches, large enough to accommodate a man's body. All three men disappeared, leaving behind only the Confederate's jackknife and a worn Union bayonet. The man who negotiated the bribe that secured the escape never came forward. But there was little doubt among Wilmington's leading whites that the conspirator who paid $1,000 to buy the sentry's cooperation was the condemned men's lawyer, Alfred Moore Waddell. Chapter 4. Marching to the Happy Land. 1 month after Colonel Waddell delivered his lecture to Wilmington's leading black residents in July 1865, an escaped slave named Abraham Galloway gave a speech of his own to a gathering of freed slaves in New Bern, 95 miles up the coast from Wilmington. It was the first time freed slaves had held a mass political meeting in North Carolina. A great sensation, the New York Times reported. Galloway, just 28 years old, was clearly in charge that day in New Bern, whose population was swollen by thousands of escaped former slaves. He was described by the Times as a mulatto, an eloquent orator and a general favorite with those who know him, a leading spirit. Frederick Douglass's abolitionist newspaper described Galloway as tall and rather portly, quadroon complexion, dark eyes, and with a handsome suit of jet black hair. His features partook strongly of the Comanche. Though functionally illiterate, Galloway had taught himself to choose words that would resonate with his audiences. His speeches had a rhythmic quality, rising in pitch when he expressed outrage. On this sweltering August day on the damp coastal flats, he chose to open his address with a demand not just for citizenship, but also for education. "We want to be an educated people and an intelligent people. We want to read and write and acquire those accomplishments which will enable us to discharge the duties of life as citizens." Galloway also demanded the right to vote, without educational requirements or other restrictions dictated by whites. If all voters were required to read and write, Galloway pointed out, perhaps half the whites in North Carolina would be ineligible. The crowd erupted in applause and knowing laughter. Galloway, energized, referred to colored Union regiments, trained and toughened, fresh from a war that had ended just a few months earlier. "If the Negro knows how to use the cartridge box, he knows how to use the ballot box." Another roar emerged from the crowd, this one louder. Galloway responded by mocking whites for their sexual hypocrisy. "The white man says he don't want to be placed on equality with the Negro," Galloway said. "Why, sir, if you could only see him slipping around at night, trying to get into Negro women's houses, you would be astonished." There was a burst of applause. A voice rang out, "That's the truth, Galloway." When Galloway's speech ended, the gathering issued a formal resolution that demanded full citizens' rights for former slaves, including the vote, in order to qualify for the higher stations of life. Copies of the resolution were distributed across southeastern North Carolina, a bold challenge at a time when whites were determined to crush black aspirations, and many blacks lived in fear of white night riders. The leaders of the New Bern meeting also announced a political convention of freedmen, the first of its kind in the South, to be held in the state capital, Raleigh, the following month, September 1865. On September 8th, Galloway placed an ad in a Wilmington newspaper. "Freedmen of North Carolina, arouse. Shake off the bands, drop the chains, and rise up in the dignity of men. The time has arrived when we can strike one blow to secure those rights of freemen that have been so long withheld from us." Over a period of 11 years, beginning in 1863, Abraham Galloway would rise from slave to state senator. He was born just outside Wilmington, came of age as a slave in the city, and fled to freedom in the North. He went behind Confederate lines during the Civil War, working as a spy for the Union Army. He returned to Wilmington after the war to help build a dynamic resistance movement against white supremacy. The path Galloway took from New Bern to Wilmington helped clear the way for a fertile strain of black defiance in Wilmington and much of southeastern North Carolina. Perhaps more than any other single man, Galloway was responsible for the transformation of many blacks in Wilmington from oppressed slaves to free men who demanded the rights promised them by their government. And it was the boldness and fortitude of the black men of Wilmington who followed Galloway's example that ultimately provoked the deadly white backlash of 1898. Galloway was born into slavery. His mother, Hester Hankins, was an illiterate black woman who was owned by the widow of a Methodist minister. Hankins was 17 when she gave birth to Abraham in 1837 in the coastal settlement of Smithville, just below Wilmington at the mouth of the Cape Fear. Abraham's father, John Wesley Galloway, was a 25-year-old descendant of Scottish sailors who made his living as a ship pilot working the Cape Fear River. Abraham later said that his white father recognized me as his son and protected me as far as he was allowed to do. John Wesley Galloway did not own his son. Abraham was the property of Marsden Milton Hankins, the son of the widow who owned Abraham's mother. Galloway considered Hankins a man of very good disposition. He always said he would sell before he would use a whip. Galloway never learned to competently read or write, but he was permitted to learn a trade as a brickmason. Because Wilmington's whites relied on blacks, both free and slave, for labor, many slaves were paid for such skilled artisan work as masons, blacksmiths, wagoners, and wheelwrights. To work his trade, Galloway was permitted to move to Wilmington, where he lived in a small cottage with Hankins, who was only 7 years older. Hankins required Galloway to provide him $15 a month from his mason's wages, along with a $15 a year head tax, about $280 today. By the time he turned 20 in 1857, Galloway had grown weary of working to pay his master. He also feared being sold at Wilmington's thriving slave market and sent to perform back-breaking labor in the sugarcane and cotton fields of the Deep South, the fate of many North Carolina slaves. Times were hard, he recalled later. I thought I would try and do better. Galloway and a fellow slave, Richard Eden, a barber, concocted a plan to escape to the north on one of the ships that transported naval stores extracted from the maritime pine forests along the Cape Fear. The two men had learned from friends that a ship captain from Wilmington, Delaware, had docked his schooner at the port of Wilmington, North Carolina. The ship was to be loaded with naval stores to be delivered to Philadelphia. The two slaves were told that the captain was sympathetic to the abolitionist struggle. The right man in the right place, they said later. They arranged with the captain to be hidden in a hold below decks. North Carolina's slave owners had passed a law requiring vessels bound for the North to be fumigated by burning turpentine dregs to smoke out stowaway slaves, while also killing mosquitoes. Typically, pots of burning turpentine were set below decks and the hatches shut tight. Galloway and Eden devised a defense. They cut oilcloth into shrouds and tied them at the waist with drawstrings, then pulled them tightly over their heads and shoulders as a sort of primitive gas mask. They also devised a makeshift bladder wrapped in wet towels to be held against their noses and mouths to ward off smoke. The ship set sail with the two fugitives in the hold, wrapped in their shrouds. To their surprise and relief, no turpentine fires were lit, but Galloway and Eden were sickened and weakened during the journey by turpentine fumes. They were ill and exhausted by the time the ship docked in Philadelphia, but they were free. They made their way through Philadelphia's narrow streets to the office of the Vigilance Committee, a stop on the Underground Railroad. There they were nursed back to health. The invigorating northern air and the kind treatment of the Vigilance Committee acted like a charm upon them, one of the committee members reported. The committee asked Galloway for one of the oilcloth shrouds and for a photograph of himself that he carried with him. The photo showed a handsome, full-faced young man dressed in a dark suit coat and white collar fastened by a patterned ascot. Even in Philadelphia, Galloway and Eden were at risk of capture by bounty hunters who had the legal right to capture escaped slaves and return them south for a reward. The committee sent the two men farther north by train in late June. On July 20, 1857, Eden wrote to the Vigilance Committee from Kingston, Ontario, to report that he and Galloway had arrived safely in Canada. Slavery across the British Empire had been abolished in 1833. Eden said he intended to open a shop. Galloway had found unspecified work paying $1.75 a day. Galloway ultimately returned to the South, where he was recruited to spy on Confederates and report back to Union officers. Posing as a slave, he traveled from Maryland to Mississippi and collected intelligence. In Union territory, he moved among captured Confederates, persuading some to sign oaths of loyalty to the Union. By 1863, Galloway had made his way to New Bern, headquarters for Union forces in the state. The city, once a Confederate coastal outpost, had fallen to Union troops the previous spring. Federal officers now lived in former Confederate homes and bivouacked in grimy camps illuminated by cooking fires. There were other camps nearby, these more squalid. Thousands of fugitive slaves had escaped plantations to seek refuge among the Union forces, settling in sprawling tent cities and shanty towns along the sluggish Trent River. Union officers called them contrabands and put them to work as laborers. In New Bern, Galloway was drawn to Mary Ann Starkey, one of the most prominent freed slaves in the city. Starkey ran a boarding house and helped organize a relief society that provided money and supplies to fugitive slave families. She held regular Bible study and evening educational classes for black adults. Raised as a slave of a prosperous New Bern merchant, Starkey had a refined eye for home furnishings and often prepared gourmet meals for Union officers. One of her table guests was Edward Kinsley, a flinty Massachusetts abolitionist. Kinsley was 33 years old, stout, with a broad face, a wide-set mouth, a high forehead, and untamed sideburns. He had helped raise money to form volunteer military units of free blacks in the North. But because there were only enough free blacks there to form two small regiments, Massachusetts Governor John Albion Andrew had enlisted Kinsley, a lifelong friend, to travel to North Carolina to raise a larger black regiment composed of fugitive slaves. Both men sought to answer a question that would help shape the course of the war. How many former slaves in North Carolina would fight and die for the Union? In May 1863, Kinsley arrived in New Bern aboard a Union steamship. He carried a military pass he had secured from President Lincoln during a White House meeting to discuss his journey to raise a colored regiment. The pass, addressed to officers of the Army of the Potomac and signed by Lincoln, read, "You will allow the bearer, Mr. Edward W. Kinsley, to pass inside our lines at whatever time he may choose and at any point he may desire, and officers will see that he has proper escort." Kinsley was confident that fugitive slaves were eager to serve the Union, but as he approached them, they seemed to be awaiting permission. Kinsley soon discovered that they deferred to a separate authority, a fugitive slave who seemed to wield enormous influence among fellow contrabands in New Bern. Among the blacks was a man of more than ordinary ability, a coal black Negro named Abraham Galloway, a military historian wrote later. The day after he arrived in New Bern, Kinsley called on Mary Ann Starkey at her boarding house. He believed that his path to Galloway lay through Starkey, whom he called a very intelligent colored woman. The next day, Starkey said something that raised Kinsley's hopes. She was expecting a couple of friends from rebel lines that evening. She told him to meet her at her boarding house at midnight. Kinsley appeared as instructed, and he soon heard footsteps. A black man appeared in the kitchen doorway just after midnight. Starkey introduced him as Uncle Isaac, the Reverend Isaac K. Felton, a well-known black minister. A second black man appeared, addressed by Starkey as Mr. Randolph, John Randolph, Jr., a freed slave and Methodist preacher. Soon a third man emerged from the darkness. Mr. Galloway, Starkey announced. Starkey led the group to a cramped upstairs room. Kinsley took a seat at a small table that held a Bible and a candle, which gave off a sickly yellow light. It was dark and close, he wrote later. Galloway and Randolph told Kinsley that they had heard rumors of an attempt to raise a colored regiment in New Bern. Kinsley described his mission. Galloway assured Kinsley that he could raise a full regiment in a matter of days, but he insisted that Kinsley first agree to several conditions. First, any colored regiment formed in New Bern would receive the same pay, uniforms, and rations as white troops. Second, the Union Army must provide shelter, supplies, and jobs for the families of black soldiers. Third, colored schools must be reopened and education for blacks guaranteed. Kinsley had no authority to agree to any of the demands, and the final demand was impossible for him or even Lincoln to satisfy. Galloway wanted an assurance that any captured black soldier would be treated by the Confederacy as a prisoner of war, not as an escaped slave. Galloway and other escaped slaves in New Bern had little faith in the Union's commitment to unfettered freedom for former slaves. The treatment of contrabands in New Bern hardly presaged a promising future. For instance, the Union Army provided small relief packages of flour, beef, bacon, and bread to 7,500 fugitive slaves and their families. But white citizens received 16 times more rations. And while white military workers earned $12 a month, black workers, who helped build military fortifications, were paid $8. Escaped slaves were serving Union troops as scouts and spies, risking their lives. Yet some Union soldiers treated blacks with contempt, ordering them to perform menial chores and showering them with racial slurs. Some Union soldiers robbed blacks of cash, tools, and horses. Two incidents in New Bern had especially incensed the fugitive slaves there. First, Edward Stanley, the military governor of Union-controlled areas of North Carolina, had closed several colored schools operated by a northern missionary. Under existing North Carolina.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.